Hi everyone, I hope you're all having a great week. About a year ago, just about when the pandemic was getting started, I was feeling a need to de-stress and started really focusing on painting again. I wanted to challenge myself a little bit, so I decided to paint my second portrait, and I picked Frida Kahlo as the subject. I started the process by doing a very rough sketch of the picture I found online on my panel board, and this is where it started to go wrong. I thought I'd be able to save the day through the painting process, but unfortunately, I was wrong about that too. So after that, I set the painting aside for a little while, and when I came back to it, what you see on my table right now is the result of what I was able to accomplish. Even though it's much better than my first try, it's still far from looking like Frida Kahlo. Last week I posted a video showing step by step how I went about reproportioning Frida's face. If you'd like to see this process, you can click on the video link up above. The video you're currently watching is divided into different chapters to make navigating easier. If you'd like to skip to a different section of this video, you can find the links to each short chapter in my video description down below. As you can see in this first short section of the video, I'm working on mixing my skin tones for the painting. I usually use a combination of warm white, yellow ochre, and cadmium red light to mix my skin tones. I will also add transparent yellow oxide, transparent red oxide, raw umber, or burnt sienna, depending on the tone I'm trying to create. For tones I'll use for shading, I usually will add a small amount of either ultramarine blue or viridian green. This is where having a good quality print of the reference image can be very useful for color matching. Pre-mixing a small variety of different tones is a good way to get started. For me, this is not an exact science just yet, and there's a lot of trial and error. Like anything else, however, the more you practice, the easier it gets. Now I'm just about done, and I'm ready to get started with the most exciting part of the process, painting. For whatever reason, I always seem to find it easiest to start working on the eyes. Since I'm in the process of reproportioning Frida's face here, she's gonna look funny for a little bit, but eventually it'll start to come together and I will feel much better about my painting. As I go along, I use the different basic tones that I mixed to mix other tones. Using the outline I created in my Fixing Frida Part 1 video last week, I now have a better guide for painting Frida's face more proportionately. Guidelines are a really great way to get a portrait painting started off on the right foot. Now, don't get me wrong, even with good guidelines, there are no guarantees your painting will result in an exact likeness of your subject. Guidelines help by providing the correct proportions of different features in the face. They also give us a rough idea of the shape of each feature, but ultimately, coloring, shading, and a good recognition of the different color values will be key to making the painting come together. As I mentioned earlier when I was talking about mixing skin tones, it's all about practice. The more I paint portraits, the better I get at it. As you can see, my very first version of this painting was really not that good. In fact, I look at it now and I laugh a little bit when I see it. Sure, I could get frustrated when my paintings don't turn out exactly as I'd like them to be. But that wouldn't be helpful, and I'd probably just end up giving up altogether. When I choose to accept where I am in my learning process, it's easier for me to offer myself the compassion and encouragement I need as a new portrait painter. I find taking pictures of my work as I go along really helps me to see the progress I'm making over time. So this is my third attempt at getting a likeness of Frida. The first attempt was far from a likeness, but I got to practice sketching and mixing my paint colors. The second attempt was also not a likeness of Frida, but stepping away from the painting for a little while gave me a chance to observe her picture more and figure out on my own some of the aspects of the portrait I wanted to fix. Finally, I decided to get out of my own way, and I opted to create a proportional outline of Frida's face using a picture roughly the same size as my painting. Now, here I am, working on my third attempt at a Frida Kahlo portrait. Armed with a little bit more experience and a better outline, I feel way better about my chances of success. I've still got a distance to go, but already I'm really happy with the progress I'm making. In a few seconds from now, you're going to see a big shift in the expression on Frida's face. I'm calling this section of the video, Frida Gets Angry. Can you see how she looks like she's pouting right now? Hold on, Frida, we'll get through it. As I mentioned in my first portrait video, when I'm painting a portrait, I like to bounce around and work on different features of the face as I'm going along. Sometimes I'm in a section and I start to feel stuck and I'm not really sure what to do next, or the paint starts to get a little bit too thick and difficult to work with. So I find moving away from that section for a little bit and working on something else can be really helpful. As I'm working, of course, I'm continuously looking at the reference image of my subject. I'm working with a photocopy of this reference image, and so the coloring is slightly different. Still, it's good to have a point of reference. I also like to keep a black and white version of the reference photo handy so that I can measure the different values in Frida's face. The whole process really takes a lot of time, a lot of patience, and a good dose of self-compassion. I think these elements are really key to remember anytime we're learning to do something new. I was able to work through some challenging aspects of the portrait, and now I'm happy to see that Frida's pout has slowly evolved to becoming a smirk. Slowly but surely, I'm seeing the transformation, and this is really encouraging to me. By now, I've been working on this painting in real time for more than a few hours. I'm having fun, and I'm feeling really energized by the progress I'm making. As I'm going along, I'm making it a point to stop my camera and take a step back from my painting so that I can look at it from different angles. It's important to do this because it helps us to retain some objectivity regarding our painting. When I'm starting to get tired, I'll eventually stop. It's important to do this instead of trying to force myself to continue working until the painting is complete. Setting the painting aside for a few hours, for a few days, or maybe even a few weeks can help us regain perspective. Thank you. here I'm about to start doing some work on the background. I'm not done, but this is a way for me again to shift my focus and regain perspective on the entire painting instead of being too focused on one area of the painting. After working on this for many hours now, I'm starting to feel that my energy is waning. So it's time for me to start thinking about taking a break. And since I'm really happy with the progress I've made so far, I think this would be a good time for me to stop. After making the decision to paint over Frida's earrings, I decided to stop and let my painting dry for a bit. I would say I waited probably around 2 weeks before I started working on it again. Taking breaks like this is good because it helps us look at the painting with fresh eyes, and it also gives my oil paint a chance to dry. I really wanted to be able to paint on a flat surface with my camera overhead so that I could show you not only my painting process, but also how I mixed my paints as I went along. But the more I worked on my painting the second time around, the more I was realizing that this angle was not working quite so well for me. I realized that painting from this angle without getting my head in front of the camera was very difficult. I was having a really hard time seeing my portrait from the right perspective. This is why I keep lifting my panel board and angling it towards me. I apologize for this, as I'm sure it doesn't make for the best kind of viewing. Eventually, to make the process easier on myself, I will move to my easel. Unfortunately, that means you won't be able to see my palette as I'm working, but I think it'll give you a much better perspective on what I'm doing. Yes, working on my easel is so much better. It's good for me to have the portrait right in front of me and to be able to work with the camera on one side and me on the other side, rather than me trying to move my head out of the camera to make sure that I can get a good shot for you. So I guess that brings me to something else that's important to consider when we're painting. Comfort is really key, and if we don't have a very comfortable setup, it's going to be difficult to work. As I'm working on multiple different projects at a time in my studio can become a little bit cluttered, and when this happens, I find my mind starts to feel a bit cluttered too, and then it becomes harder to work. When this happens, I like to get back to the basics and just do a little bit of tidying up, just to clear up my space and give me the room to feel comfortable working. I like to set everything up in advance and make sure I have all of my painting supplies and paintbrushes, etc., handy so that I can access everything very easily as I'm painting. When I get in a good workflow, I like to have as few distractions as possible. Sometimes I like listening to music when I paint, and other times I just like it to be quiet. It really depends on my mood. What about you? How do you like to make your space comfortable for creating? The very first portrait I ever painted was a painting I worked on for months. I painted it in acrylics, and it wasn't quite as easy to work with. I was a little scared to work with oil paints at the time, so I worked with the medium I knew the best. But acrylic paints dry really fast, and it can make working time very difficult. Because acrylics dry so fast, you have very little time to work in blending them. So that means if you want to work on a section and get your paints blended, you almost need to stick to that section of the painting before moving on to something else. Since I worked up the courage to give oil paints another go, I find that it's made my portrait painting process so much easier. Oil paints take a lot more time than acrylic paints to dry. This means they're also a lot easier to blend. When painting portraits, I find blendability to be one really important factor to consider. Still, even though they are easier to blend, it can be a bit of a challenge when you're first starting to work with them because they are so blendable. When you move to a section that you've left for a while, the paint may still not be dry and it may shift when you start painting over it. Having a clean blending brush handy is a good way to erase some of those shifts that may happen as you're painting. As an artist, Frida had a very colorful way of expressing herself, not only in her artwork, but also through her sense of style. In the reference photo I picked as my subject, she was wearing big earrings and some necklaces. For this painting, I decided to omit her jewelry. Since this is a painting I'm making for myself, maybe at some point down the road I'll decide to add the jewelry and I'll get back to the portrait and do that. But for now, I'm just focusing on Frida herself and I'm going to add some more flowers and leaves to the background. That's one of the other fun things about being the person making the painting. You get to decide how you want to make it, what you want to include, what you don't want to include, because really, you're doing this for yourself. Green is my favorite color, and it makes me really happy to be able to put more of it in my painting. I didn't know it at this point, but my phone was about to die and the recording was about to stop. Thankfully, I was able to capture most of my painting process for you. So my painting is maybe not an exact likeness of Frida, but it's a whole lot better than it was the very first time I tried. My second attempt was better, but I think it still wasn't all that great. And though my final attempt didn't result in an exact likeness, I think it is far better than what it was before, and I'm super happy with the results. Thank you for joining me on this journey. I really appreciate you making the time to watch this video. If you have any questions or comments, please add them below. I'd love to hear from you. I'm wishing you all a wonderful week and happy creating!